Introduction. In this talk, what I'm going to try and do is run through the Internet of Things and how it has evolved and what are the various applications that have been evolved for it, both in the consumer space. That's something that probably all of you would have been more aware of if you're reading a lot of tech blogs and things like that. But another part of the Internet of Things, which is the industrial internet. I'll cover that in some detail and take any questions. So all my animations have gone. So all my slides are going to look a little busy. So I hope that's all right. My name is Sahil Kinney. I'm an engineer from IIT Madras. Although I did my engineering in metallurgical and materials engineering, so I veered off into a completely different path after that. After that, I worked at McKinsey & Company as a management consultant, working out of the Bombay office for a couple of years. Served a bunch of sectors, but there again, I was an operational guy. I mean, I fine-tuned operations. My family business is manufacturing paints. So I've grown up in the kind of enterprise and operations aspect of things constantly being in a, and I know their pain points. After that, I worked for the Aadhaar project, Nandan Nilekani's UID project, where I set up their contact center, where, once you enroll for Aadhaar, I think one of your inevitable questions is, where is my Aadhaar card? And I set up the contact center where you call to, where they don't give you any answers because it's India Post's fault. But that's a different issue. After that, I worked for a startup in Bangalore, and post that, most recently, I was at Titan. There, I looked at new businesses for Titan and what are the new areas that they could potentially enter. Doesn't want to go to the next page. So I was hoping to have a bigger room in front of me when I said this. But please tell your friends, please tell everyone. This is the name of my company. It's an industrial internet company. It's a company that builds hardware and software to connect factory floors, buildings, HVAC systems, all these things to the internet and actually take and analyze that data. So, please feel free to email me, come see me after the talk. I'm always looking to meet new people. We're looking to build a very cool team. Tushit there is my partner. Right. So, this is something that really caught my eye when I saw it, which was when you start looking at the number of people connected to the internet versus the number of devices connected to the internet. Anything in blue is the number of devices. And here's the interesting thing. Around 2008, was the point we actually, the number of devices connected to the internet surpassed the number of people connected to the internet. And that number is going to exponentially grow over the period of time. And this is what interests me. These things are not just smartphones and tablets. If you look at the disparity in growth, it's mostly devices that are taking off. So it can't just be smartphones and tablets. I mean, how many more smartphones and tablets do you expect people to buy over the per person over the next few years? That's not going to change. So it's going to be different devices, and that's the takeaway that I want you to have from this slide. And how is that possible? What's enabling it? What's making it possible that 50 billion devices connected to the internet? Now, most of you are techies, so you'll probably already know about IPv4 and how it had only 4 billion addresses, which we ran out of in Feb 2011. So there was this whole panic about we need more IP addresses, we can't just keep this is just not tenable. We won't be able to build anything going forward. So they came out with a new standard called IPv6. That's 2 to the power 128 addresses. That's that many addresses. Wait, what? That's 52,000 trillion addresses per person, or 100 for every atom on the planet, or 4.8 million for every star in the known universe. That number is apparently 7 to the power 22, which, you know, just random useless facts. But that basically what the takeaway from that is that you can there's a lot of devices that can connect to the internet, and we don't think we'll run out of them even if we plug the sensor to every atom on the planet 100 times over. Obligatory big data slide. So obviously if you're, I mean, every big data is a big buzzword, everybody wants to talk about it. So you come to the position where this data, where is the source of the data? What is that data? That really is the question. So first question you'll ask is how much data are we generating? Because that's a nice, you know, pointless number. Fun, again, useless fact, you could go to Pluto back and forth 60 times with the bookshelf with the data that is generated this year. But that's the whole thing, right? It's Parkinson's law. I mean, beyond a point, the number doesn't make any sense. It's just completely beyond our scope of understanding how many zeros actually come after that. But what's more important, rather than just the volume of the data, is because most of it is video, most of it is compressed images, that the 90 plus percent of the content is video. So how much processing are you really going to run on that? Whereas if you look at sensor networks, these are the ones that are actually going to be the data sources going forward. This is what's actually going to cause the next big application layer of big data, if you will. This is what will actually give you things that people can use. So I've already gone through this. I mean, this is how the trend of connected devices per person. Currently, we're at 2.5 connected devices for every person on the planet right now, and that's going to go up to 6.5. So it's a bit of a absurd thing. So if it's not just phones and tablets, and what kind of sensors are they? What is it that we're actually talking about here? So we have both consumer and industrial. So If you split it up, and consumer is where the Internet of Things that you and I know of is actually sitting now, and that actually splits up as personal and home. So I'll talk about each of these things, but home automation and your all data collected about you counts as the personal Internet, objects that are close to you that connect to the Internet, right? The second part is the industrial Internet. And the industrial Internet splits up, if it will come here, into cities and factories. So how do you connect entire cities? How do you connect entire factories? What is the kind of data you can extract from these giant at scale outfits that are continuously generating data, process data, data about system data, all kinds of data? So what are you going to do with all of that? And that's where the value really is, in my opinion. Right, the Internet of You. So for me, I think this really started with Star Trek and the whole quantified self, right? I mean, with the whole beam me up, Scotty, and teleportation, it was actually Sulu could be sitting on the bridge and actually be tracking their vitals. So they constantly have information about their heart rate, about where they're running. So that's all metadata. It's all metadata about the crew. So that's remote transmission, right? And that's essentially what we're doing today with. Sorry. With Google Glass, with the Jawbones up, with and with Fitbit. I mean, look at this. It's a dashboard that essentially, in many different ways, gently, first of all, tracks your activity, then visualizes it, and then gently presents it to you in ways that drive you to a particular goal. So this is the Internet of Things, big data, and gamification all rolled into one bucket, if you will. These are all those buzzwords, right? If you look at the Internet of Home, bunch of really, really cool, I mean, I'm not talking about the days of Crestron and, you know, one of those resistive touchpads that you have to, like, press, you know, in the middle of a conference room. If you ever try to switch on and off a light, you know how infuriating it could be using that kind of technology. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about current Web 2.0, really new age technology, which is smartphone enabled. This is Belkin's range of home automation products called the Vimo. Comes with an app, control anything you want. That's a motion detector, that's a plug point that goes in and allows you to control You could switch on and off your TV, this projector, whatever you want, you name it, right? This is the Nest thermostat. This was designed by one of the guys who actually designed the iPod. Beautiful brushed aluminium with this display that changes color. It's actually an intelligent thermostat, and it's given the market leader for thermostats, which is Honeywell, complete run for its money. Honeywell is one of those old school, you know, it started with almost like a Bakelite radial control kind of thing, and it's past Bakelite now, but the point is that this thing came and completely blew it out of the water. It's a learning thermostat. It can actually sense what temperature it is outside, set the temperature accordingly, know when you're coming home, know your habits, and then, you know, pre-cool the house or switch off the AC to save you electricity. And it has an online dashboard and everything. connects over Wi-Fi. So this is a Locketron. Again, very similar device. 60% of the locks in the US are of a type called the cylindrical deadbolt. Okay, a cylindrical deadbolt basically sits above the twisty part of your door, above the handle, and that's basically, you'd have seen them, right, in all these American movies. They close the door and then they do this. That's the deadbolt. This thing basically is the retrofit device that goes on top of that. So there's no new lock. You don't replace anything. You don't change anything. You just put this on, and in a very, very super cool way, you give it your Wi-Fi password, basically through bursts of light. There's an app that basically communicates the Wi-Fi password to an optical sensor inside the hardware through strobe. And then you program it with the Wi-Fi password, and boom. This thing's connected to the internet. That app allows you to open and close the door from anywhere and give access to your friends, keys, all of that, right? That's called the Locketron. Finally, come on, Chromebook. There we go. This is called SmartThings. This is more of a platform play in home automation. This consists of this kind of SmartThings hub. And it connects to all these other devices which you deploy all over your home. You know, motion detectors, on and off switches, other sensors that you might want to have, humidity sensor in your basement, or XYZ, different kinds of sensors. And it connects to this hub via Zigbee. So it's low power, cuts through this thing, so you don't have to give everything a Wi-Fi connection. So it's a nice way of kind of aggregating or rather distributing this task to different devices through a single internet connection. This again pairs with an online engine called IFTTT. I don't know how many of you have heard that. If this then that, and you can, it has a channel on if this then that where you can configure things for different kinds of applications. When you put it at a city level, what you essentially have is Skynet. Any Terminator fans here? No. Skynet is basically the sentient control network that takes over the world and you know, sends back Arnold. So it's pretty scary. But the point is, if you look at these are the primary applications of the Internet of Cities, if you will, connecting the electricity grid so that at any given point in time you can do dynamic load balancing. The thing with the grid is, the funny thing about electricity is that it should be consumed at the same rate as it's generated. It's in a constant dynamic balance, right? There is no, it's not like a battery. You can't store it unless you have actual storage reserves. And you know, storing megawatts of electricity isn't easy right now. So you want to constantly balance the load across the city, do pricing across peak hours and non-peak hours, know how much leakage is occurring where. All these kind of things you can do actually if you have some decent power quality sensors that at all these places and energy meters. You can have a very, very good picture of how your city's energy is being distributed from a very, very sensible, very, how much money is this costing me, how much time and money is spent kind of generating this electricity, that kind of a scale. Water and utilities, again, imagine BESCOM or BWSSB. I know we don't associate them with much competence, but there they are, you know, if they're in their control rooms, you should be able to control all the valves for different water sumps, for different drains and XYZ, and then you have traffic and pollution monitoring, which you know you'd expect the government to do, but somebody else, some other big brother is doing it. Any guesses? No really need to guess. It's Google Maps. They do it with your phones. So they already know. And it's very reliable. Have any of you actually tried Google Maps traffic? It's really bad when it says the traffic is bad somewhere, the traffic is bad there. It's quite amazing. They've actually figured it out on Indian Road.
It's the density of connected
correct, phones. Correct. It's crazy, right? Because we have so many phones, we can build that kind of a system. And think about it. We have now real-time data on Bangalore roads. It's incredible when you really picture it. Because we don't really have real-time data on anything in this country. But, you know.
The Kerala government, so I think it tied up with Ludura Solutions, installed about 1.5 million smart meters.
Correct. So that made Flutura's business, by the way. Flutura became huge because of that deal. Somebody must have been friends with them, this thing. But my point is that if governments are far-sighted enough to look at that scale, and they're fairly reliable systems. I mean, Flutura is doing a fantastic job actually giving them the data and providing a control system on that.
There's a good predictive analytics.
Exactly. I'm going
to
come to that.
To send engineers to the right places.
Correct. So predictive analytics is for me the killer application of the Internet of Things, and I'm going to come to that when. But thanks for bringing that up. That's really insightful. I'll give you a brief of how something like that works. Smart meters, but predictive analytics in anything, and how continuously monitoring something actually saves you a lot of money. All these usual suspects, if they decide to appear on screen. Whoa. What?
Next week is
good. Alright, so these are the usual suspects. Rockwell Automation, Honeywell, Schneider Electric, Emerson Process Management. These build process control solutions. If you were a chemical engineer and you would have gone through all these process control systems and you know things to control valves and motors and pumps and chillers, and these are all things that you need when you're manufacturing something. No factory can run without pumps, no factory can run without motors, no factory can run without air handling units, without chillers, without a transformer, without this kind of equipment. So what these guys did was build equipment to track, monitor this kind of data. And how they did that, basically the problem was they actually would take sensors, connect it up, and then actually run a cable to a server sitting in the factory. So basically the equipment would arrive at a factory in 2 minutes. This give me another couple of minutes.
I think you speed it up.
Yeah, so equipment would arrive in the factory and then they would take 3 months to just run cables to it. So the thing was, it was very high cost, it was very, I've had some issues with my
own.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do. So the problem with these things is they were very high cost. It took a long time to implement. And what's wrong with this picture is just that. The fact that all of the data comes to one machine and is just bottlenecked there. And then after that, you can't share it with other people. You can't really do too much powerful analysis on it because all the data is stuck on one machine. And because of the old kind of the kind of machines that they were built for, the kind of software that you have to monitor it and the control interfaces you have are quite terrible in general. So what kind of stuff could you use it for? You could use it for a bunch of things. You could use it for tracking objects, you could use it for controlling the position of different valves, you could use it to get predictive data on how a pump or a facility is actually moving at any given point in time, and then otherwise you'd have to send oil field engineers to these rigs every month or so to actually fix this stuff. And pump data, for example, we were talking about predictive analytics, right? You could actually monitor the vibration profile of a pump over a long period of time, and then when you actually start noticing, when the pump's filter actually starts getting clogged, you will actually notice a small variation in its vibration profile. So yeah, I can actually tell before a pump gets clogged, that is getting clogged, and you can send someone there to fix it. These are PLCs, so you can actually collect entire data from an entire production line and take it to the internet and analyze it and do a bunch of this thing with it. I have a couple more slides to run through. That's it. Yeah, I will. I started late because the speaker wasn't there, so just give me a couple of minutes. So I'll skip a couple of slides, but what does it take? What does it take to do the Internet of Things? The first thing is basically you need connected sensors. And ideally in this world, because it's so easy to do wireless, you need connected wireless sensors that can actually take data, physical data, and transport it to the cloud, right? Once you take it to the cloud, you can actually run your own code, you can do whatever you want, you can do visualizations, analysis. Actually, there's a four-layer pyramid. It's called data, information, knowledge, and then wisdom. So you take it up that pyramid basically by taking that, reams and reams of data, analyzing it for trends, and then from that you actually relate it to what the process is, because you can't really make use of pump data if you don't know that it's pump data. So that's what you do next. So how would you, if you wanted to build an Internet of Things system, it's quite possible to do that quite easily these days. There are actually a lot of really cool hobbyist hardware, two of which are very promising, one called the Electric Imp and one called Spark Core, both of which connect very easily to most real-world devices, and they have a onboard Wi-Fi chip, which is usually Arduino compatible, that you can program to send the data from that you capture straight to their cloud. So the problem is you can't use it for enterprise applications because they own the cloud part of it as well. So the data goes to their servers. So that's something that an industrial system would never accept. But if you're doing hobbyist stuff, it's really, really good for you. Cloud, of course, I don't really need to talk to you about it, but you can host it on a bunch of solutions. If you are not doing Electric Imp or Spark, you would need a cloud service and a kind of wireless module on this side of things. Here, ideally, you should be writing your own code to actually do what it is, the analysis that you want to do. I talked briefly about if this, then that, and how that's basically an engine for taking an input, making applying a condition or an operation, and then pushing an output or a response. But like I said, to actually be able to take insight from the data, you want to be able to see it. And to see it well, you want to be able to dashboard it really well in interactive visualizations. And some great frameworks for that are D3.js, which actually gives you a great statistical toolkit to actually process that data and show it to you in very powerful ways. If you're a JavaScript guy, you've definitely heard of it. Again, HiCharts is the same thing. GeckoBoard actually has made a business out of just making dashboards for businesses. So I'm almost done. Why IoT now? Because I think the pieces of the puzzle have only just come together. And what are the pieces of the puzzle? For me, these are the pieces of the puzzle. Low cost sensors, low power wireless, IPv6. That gets you the data to the cloud. Analytics on the cloud gives you an OS for the real world. I've got one slide left. So essentially, this is what we do at MagnetWorks. We take a lot of sensor data and we build a piece of hardware called the Red Box, which pairs with this hardware and basically takes that data, sends it to the cloud, where we do all of these things. We provide dashboards, we do trends, we'll even provide an API. We'll allow you to do remote diagnostics on your PLC, and then view alerts and allow you to do predictive maintenance through data. So that's essentially a brief introduction. I'm sorry I had so many issues with my this thing. Like I said, again, we're hiring, so if you know anyone who might be interested in this kind of work, I guarantee you it'll be really cool working with some really cool hardware. Thanks again, thanks for your time.